First Samuel chapter 1, verse 9. So Hannah rose up after they had eaten in Shiloh and after they had drunk. Now Eli the priest sat upon a seat by a post of the temple of the Lord. I want you to look at the scene. And she was in bitterness of soul and prayed unto the Lord and wept sore. And she vowed a vow and said, O Lord of hosts, if thou wilt look on the affliction of thine handmaid and remember me and not forget thy handmaid, but will give unto thy handmaid a male child, a man child, then I will give him unto the Lord all the days of his life, and there shall no razor come upon his head. I want you now to reach out and catch your neighbor by the hand and say, neighbor,
neighbor,
never give up.
Never give up.
Turn to somebody else and say, neighbor,
neighbor,
never give up.
Neighbor.
I think let's just say it one more time. Neighbor,
neighbor,
never give up.
Never give up.
Yeah, that's good to get down into your spirit. Because in life, we all encounter circumstances and situations that really cause us to want to give up. Sometimes the easiest thing in our minds for the moment is to run and get away from a situation that is unpleasant. One of the hardest things for us to do is to wait for something to come our way today that we really wanted to happen yesterday. The main character in our text today is a barren woman by the name of Hannah. Clearly, she appears to love God and her husband, but she still, are you with me? She's still barren. She's living right, but barren. She's thinking right, but barren. She's praying right, but barren. Is there anyone listening to me that can relate to Hannah? I mean, you've searched yourself and you've asked God to search you as well. And as far as you can tell, your walk is tight, but there's still something in your life that's not right. I'm talking to at least three people here. Hannah goes through this terrible season of heartache and heartbreak as she wonders why she can't do what she longs to do, and that is to give birth to a child. At some point, most women desire to give the gift of life and join the prestigious club of motherhood. Now, in our culture of hands-on management, it is often implied that couples, and women in particular, control if and when they conceive. They have a built-in plan. I'm going to go to school. I'm going to finish school. I'm going to embrace my career. I'm going to get married, and then I'm going to have children on this particular year or at this particular time. But watch this. But for many women, it seems like, watch this, it seems like when they look at a man too hard, they get pregnant. Am I talking to somebody in here that's very fertile? Now, we know that that's not possible in most cases. Outside of Adam and Eve and Jesus, life under normal conditions is conceived based on sexual interaction between a man and a woman. And let me add this, according to the word of God, the man and the woman involved in that sexual interaction should be married to each other. I am so glad that I can stand on the word of God and I don't let the people scare me into coming up with something that's not written and therefore not fitting. You should be married. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 2, turn to your neighbor and say, you should be married. Yeah, yeah, praise the Lord. We got Brother Harris and the Harrises in the house. You should be married. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians 7, 2, to avoid fornication, let every man have his own wife and every woman her own husband. Are you with me now? It means that you don't go trying to dip and tip with somebody hoping that they're going to become your husband. You got to set boundaries and you should not make the bar so low. Oh, let me move on. Amen. But even doing things in alignment with the word of God, it doesn't always mean that things are going to go according to plan. Recent numbers from the National Survey of Family Growth tells us that approximately 6.7 million women in America are unable to bear children due to infertility. That's about 11% of women in the reproductive age, which is 15 to 44. Most experts define infertility as not being able to get pregnant after 1 year of trying, along with women who are able to get pregnant, but then they have repeated miscarriages. In today's society, infertility is treated with medicine and assisted reproductive technology, often called ART. But even with the new technology, hear me out very carefully, in many cases, the only way for a woman to get pregnant is by divine intervention. I see, I thank God for the three people that said amen, because for some reason we have factored God out of the equation and man is deciding whether or not a child is born. I want you to understand it is God who gives life and it is God who decides when that life will be taken away. I remember when Lloyd was born, my wife went through a very traumatic situation. It was awesome. I was trying to be a good husband and start off by being a good dad, but something went wrong. I'm not going to talk about what went wrong, but they got me out of the room and all of the doctors from that department came in, and the head physician says, I've never seen anything like this before. Now, Lloyd was born. It was touch and go all the way, but he made it. But at the end of it all, the doctor told me and my wife, don't ever think about having another child because it's over. And we walked out of there just glad she was alive. Are you all praying with me? Because sometimes you're just glad to be alive. Things may not go the way you want them to go, but I'm just glad to be alive. I'm glad to be on the planet. I'm glad to have my health and strength and the activity of my limbs and the soundness of my mind. You ought to be glad about what God has done in your life. And I remember being glad, but as time moved on, my wife says, I want to have another child. Now, you have to understand, the doctors have told her and told us there are no more children that are part of the equation. But when God allowed us to come down here, we met a woman by the name of Overseer Mary Mullen. And she told me and my wife, boy, girl, don't you listen to them doctors. You get you some Geritol, and we're going to pray over you, and we're going to see what God will do. And I'm telling you, it wasn't long before my wife got pregnant with my daughter, Christina, who was just directing the choir. And if God had not intervened, and Geritol, I got to give Geritol and Overseer Mullen some credit. Are you with me? Had they not been on the scene, she would not be in the church. Are you all praying with me? I'm telling you, the God that we serve, he's able. Turn to somebody and say he's able. You go ahead and give him a praise for what he's done for you. I know there's something else you want him to do, but you ought to praise him right now for what he's already done. I know you want to go to a new level, but praise him for the level that you're on. Oh, that men would praise the Lord. Oh, that men would give me glory for what I've already done. And so, brothers and sisters, there's a problem Hannah faced in her day. And it's still a problem that many women are facing in our day today. Here's the issue. Hannah and God wanted the same thing, but for completely different reasons. Hannah wanted a son, but God wanted a servant. Hannah wanted a man-child, but God wanted a priest. Hannah wanted a boy to show off to the people, but God wanted a judge to lead the people. Now keep in mind, our plan is not necessarily the plan of God. I've come to tell you this morning, God is not our Santa Claus. Whenever you ask God for something, you have to factor in how that something is going to be a blessing to God. Whenever I think about the church, I ask God, I say, God, I pray that you will send people that we will love and those that will love us. And together, we will love you. I'm always factoring in God because God understands who's supposed to be here. He understands when they're supposed, how we're supposed to interact. He understands how he's going to get glory out of every vessel that's in the house of God. Now keep in mind again, our plan is not necessarily God's plan. So Hannah does five things in our lesson today that brings her into alignment with the will of God. Number one, Hannah prays. Hannah prays. Turn to somebody and say, you gotta pray. You gotta pray. See, praying puts you in touch with God. Thinking puts you in touch with yourself. If you knew what to do, you would have already done it. So we got to pray. We got to reach outside of ourselves and believe that the God of creation is also our God. The Bible says in James 5:16, the effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man or woman availeth much. Look at 1 Samuel chapter 1, verse 10. 1 Samuel chapter 1, verse 10, the Bible says, in bitterness of soul, Hannah prayed to the Lord and wept sore. Are you with me? She's hurting, but she's praying. She's weeping, but she's praying. I mean, she's weeping uncontrollably. I mean, with heaves, she's weeping, but she's praying. There are times when you're going to go through an unusual struggle that causes you to pray an unusual prayer. I often ask God, don't let me go through something just so that I can take time to talk to you. Am I with anybody here? Because when you go through hard places, you have a tendency to talk to God in ways that you've never talked to God before. Sometimes you have to pray a consecrated prayer. Sometimes you have to pray, I'm giving it all I got kind of prayer. Sometimes you got to pray, I'm going to scream and I'm going to cry until I get my answer kind of prayer. I don't know what kind of prayer you prayed for, but I'm telling you today, don't you dare hold that thing in. If you got something you want from God, you got to let God know. I mean, in no uncertain terms, Father God, I stretch my hand to thee. No other help I know. If you withdraw from me, God, I got nowhere else to go. Help me. Am I talking to anybody right here? Am I talking to anybody in this place today? Watch this. There are times, brothers and sisters, if you want something you never had, you got to do something you've never done. You got to go the extra mile. Not because you're going to necessarily get what you want. You got to let God know. I want you to know, God, I really want it. I know I can't make you do anything, but I want you to know I really want it. I'm not trying to be cool. I'm not trying to be reserved here. I know who's in charge. I need your help. And so Hannah prayed an extraordinary prayer. And the Bible tells us in 1 Samuel 1:12, she prayed continuously. Number two, Hannah makes a vow. A vow is a solemn promise by which someone is bound to an act, a service, or a condition. Now, Hannah may have been praying something like, God, give me a son and I'll teach him to pray. Or, give me a son and I'll help, and I'll teach him to read scriptures. I'll have him read them every day. Or I'll take him to the temple every week to worship. Or I'll teach him to tithe. She may have been praying like that, but watch this. It wasn't getting the results. So she goes for broke. The Bible says in 1 Samuel chapter 1, verse 11, she vowed a vow. If none of that's working, because my soul is in bitterness. If none of that is working, oh Lord, hosts of hosts, if you will indeed look upon the affliction of your handmaid and remember me and not forget me, but give me a man child, then I will give him back to you all the days of his life, and there shall no razor cut his head. Yes, now watch this. Yes, in other words, she said he's going to be a Nazarite. Yeah. No razor will touch his head. No wine will touch his lips. And he will not touch anything that is not alive. If you give him to me, I'll give him back to you. I'll consecrate him from the womb to the tomb. See, right now, let me say something. Whatever it is you want, you don't have. So why not give God what he wants from you? Why are you holding back? I don't want to promise too much because I might not give it. You've got nothing to give right now. So promise him every single thing that you think he might want. You've been in God long enough. You're spiritually sharp enough to know that God may want something from you that you're not willing to give to him. I'm telling you right now, let go and let God have it. Watch this. She says, I'm going to give him back to you. Brothers and sisters, if you have a need, you got to sow a seed. And after sowing the seed, if you still have a need, sow a greater seed. And when you need something, a big, real big blessing, then you sow a real big seed. Offer God something or someone. Watch this. That means something to you. No. I'm working on this right now. If what you're giving God doesn't get your attention, why do you think it's going to get his attention? I got to give God something that really means something to me. It could be in the form of a tithe or an offering. It could be in the form of time or talent. It could be in the form of someone or something. But whatever it is, it must matter to you. And you should give it with an attitude of gratitude. Don't give anything grumbling. God doesn't want your grumbling offering here. Take it. I can see God saying, no, you take it back. Number three, when you make a vow to God, don't box him in. When you make a vow to God, don't box him in. It's a really interesting piece that I have right here. Watch this. In our text, Hannah made her vow to the Lord, but she got an answer from the servant of the Lord. Look at 1 Samuel chapter 1, verse 12. The Bible says, and I'm going to read from the New International Version, 1 Samuel chapter 1, verse 12, and as she kept on praying to the Lord, Eli observed her. Hannah was praying in her heart and her lips were moving, but her voice was not heard. Eli thought she was drunk. Are you with me? Drunk woman and come to church. Talk to me, somebody. You look at your neighbor. Look at your neighbor, Ripper. Don't look at them long. You don't know what they're going through. You see some people running up and down the aisles, and you say, hey, don't take all that. Leave them alone. Leave them alone. Don't you dare touch them. Don't leave them alone. You don't know what they're going through. You don't know what God is taking them through to get to their destiny. He thought she was drunk, and she said in verse number 14, how, and said unto her, this is what Eli says in verse number 14, how long are you going to stay drunk? Put away your wine. She now responds, not so, my Lord, Hannah replied, I am a woman who is deeply troubled. I have not been drinking wine or beer. I was pouring out my soul to the Lord. Didn't that some tight stuff? I was thinking the other day, I'm hearing people just bumping, bouncing, doing worldly stuff. And it's amazing because I've never heard believers bumping and doing godly stuff. I mean, listen, you done paid all that money for that stereo system. And nobody knows it's there but you. If they gonna bump and bop down the street, you should praise and worship down the street. All right, let me move on. Look at verse number 16, 1 Samuel 1, 16. This is what Hannah says. Do not take your servant for a wicked woman. I have been praying here out of my great anguish and grief. Eli answered, go in peace, and may the God of Israel grant you what you have asked of him. I like this. Whatever it is. Eli doesn't ask her what you've been praying for. He just recognizes, if you've been praying like that, then I'm going to ask God to grant you whatever it is you've asked for. She said, watch this, verse 18, may your servant find favor in your eyes. Then she went her way and ate something, and her face was no longer downcast. Notice the turnaround. She's praying to God, needing an answer from God, but she gets the answer from the servant of God who's been ordained by God. I'm going somewhere now. Just stay with me for a minute. I'm not going to stay here long. I have never in my life heard so many people tell me what the Lord told them. The Lord said, I was going over this, and God said, wait a minute. And God said, God has spoken to you like 22 times in 1 week. If you take the whole Bible, God didn't speak to everybody in the Bible as often as he's spoken to the people who say, I was praying and God told me. No. God speaks to us through his word. Any messenger that tells you anything has to tell you something based on the word of God. Are you all staying with me right now? If listen, there are times when I perceive that the Lord wants me to do something. But that's based on my experiences, my interaction with the Word, my interaction with the people that are interacting with the Word. Come on, are you all staying with me? Are you staying with me? That's why you can have a person that says, I think I can be a Christian and be a homosexual. Now I'm not knocking homosexuals at all. I'm just saying it's not written in the Word. That's why you can have people that say, I could be saved and commit adultery and fornication. I'm not knocking those that commit adultery and fornication. I'm saying it's not in the Word. If I do what's in the Word, now I can sugarcoat this thing. I think it's okay because, you know, all have sinned and all have come short of the glory of, oh yeah. We've all sinned and we've all come short of glory. God, that doesn't give us a ticket to keep sinning and to keep coming short of the glory of God. Am I talking about, even if you're guilty of coming short of the glory of God, you need to repent. God, I'm so sorry. I missed the mark. Can I get somebody to pray with me today? In the name of Jesus. Because this is some tough stuff right here, man. Because everybody doesn't see things the same way. Because everybody doesn't see things his way. Amen? Okay, now watch this. Watch this. Watch this. There is this turnaround. So many times when we can't receive a breakthrough because we're waiting on God to directly speak to us, to say something or do something profound just for us. But that's not how it normally happens. Oh, Lord. Turn to your neighbor again. Look at him. Take a moment. Greet somebody you don't know. You already know the people you know. Amen. You're still where you are. I need to meet somebody I don't know, that God has dropped a word in their heart, in their life, that they've been reading something that's just for me. But watch this. If I'm going to just stay in my little circle, I keep my same little information. It's only when I break out of the information, out of the circle, that I get new information. Come on, am I working with somebody here? Turn to your name and say, stop being scared. I want to say this, we're all messed up in some way. Some of us may be a little more messed up than others, but God, he saved us. All right. So often the message of God comes from the messenger of God, whoever he or she might be, that is in alignment with God and proclaims the word of God.
Come on, Bishop.
I'm getting ready to get out of here. The message of God comes from the messenger of God, whoever he or she might be, that is in alignment with God and proclaims the word of God. Go with me to Luke chapter 16. Are you there yet? Please don't say amen. Okay, Luke chapter 16. I'm going to start at verse 19. I'm going to read from the New International Version. All right? Ready? Okay, I got three people who said amen.
Amen.
Okay. There was a rich man who was dressed in purple and fine linen and lived in luxury every day. Verse 20, Luke 16, verse 20. At his gate was laid a beggar named Lazarus, covered with sores and longing to eat what fell from the rich man's table. Even the dogs came and licked his sores. That's a horrible situation to be in. Most of us don't have any idea what that's like. We give God praise, we give him glory, we give him honor. Amen? Now the Bible says in verse 22, the time came when the beggar died and angels carried him to Abraham's side. The beggar died and the angels carried him to Abraham's side. The rich man also died and was buried in Hades. In some interpretations, it's hell. In Hades, where he was in torment, he looked up and saw Abraham afar away, far away, with Lazarus by his side. The rich man, I'm going to just paraphrase here, wants Abraham to allow Lazarus to dip his finger in some water and cool his tongue because he's tormented in the flames. Isn't that amazing? If you miss heaven, you're going to be in torment and you're going to need somebody to give you some cool water. Turn to somebody and say, I'm not missing heaven. But Abraham informed the man who in life was rich. He says, when you were living, you had everything. And the beggar had nothing. Now the scene has reversed itself. The beggar has everything. You've got nothing. And Abraham informed him that there is a great chasm or gulf that separates them one from the other. Look at verse number 27, Luke 16, 27. He answered. This is the previous rich man. Answered, nothing wrong with being rich, just keep it in perspective. He answered, then I beg you, Father, send Lazarus to my family, for I have five brothers. Let him warn them so that they will not also come to this place of torment. Wow. Listen to what Abraham said. They have Moses and the prophets. Let them listen to them. No, Father Abraham, no, he said. But if someone from the dead goes to them, they will repent. Listen to what Abraham said. He said to him, if they will not listen to Moses and the prophets, they will not be convinced even if someone rises from the dead. That shows how hard-hearted and stubborn some folks can get rather than to receive Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior of their lives. I want to share this with you because everybody's looking for a miracle. I'm telling you right now, let's give you a little preview. You got one right here in your hand. You got one. You got one right in your heart. You've got the miracle that God wants you to have. I want you to understand, miracles never trump. No pun intended. Miracles never trump the Lord our God who gives power to the messengers of God. Now, for those of you that have a problem listening to other men, I've come to tell you, get over it. Because that's how it's done. You understand? I want to talk to God myself. God said, well, just stay in silence there. Because I'm not talking to you. All right? Go with me to Mark chapter 16. God is helping us right here. You getting something this morning? Praise the Lord. Look at Mark chapter 16, verse 15. Mark chapter 16, verse 15. Mark chapter 16, verse 15. I'm going to read 15 and 16. After the resurrection of Jesus, he tells his disciples, verse number 15, go in all the world and preach the gospel to all creation. King James says to every creature. Whosoever believes and is baptized shall be saved. Whoever does not believe will be condemned. The King James Version says, whosoever believeth and is baptized shall be saved. Whosoever believeth not shall be damned. Okay? Now, don't miss this. God is the one who saves or condemns, but men and women, boys and girls, are the ones who preach the gospel or the word of God that is believed or rejected. Why do you think the devil doesn't want you to say anything about the gospel? Because if you don't talk and I don't talk, then the rest of the folks who don't know him will never know him. Are you all staying with me? It is God who does the saving or the condemning, but we have to give the message. Now, don't get it twisted. In every situation, God gets the glory. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 21 says, verse 29 says, so that no one can boast before him. That's the New International Version. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 29 in the King James Version says, that no flesh can glory in his presence. No flesh can glory in his presence. If somebody gets saved, you haven't saved them. All you've done is given them the word of God that will save them. Are you all with me? Are you all with me? Are you with me? Do you know a cousin that's not saved? Are you satisfied with your cousin not being saved? Are you satisfied with your brother not being saved? Are you satisfied with your son or your daughter not being saved? So what are they going to do? Hang up on you? Do you mean to tell me you're so concerned about not being rejected that you allow them to go to Hades? Let them reject you. Let them hang up on you. You got a phone? You got an iPhone and Android? Text them. Are you with me? Are they going to block you? Write them a note. Send them an email. Talk to me, somebody. We've got to do. Nobody in my house is going to be lost. You all praying with me in the name of Jesus? You praying with me? Nobody on my job. You're going to ask God, show me a way to minister to these people. They tell you, don't talk about Jesus on the job. Okay, I'm not going to say anything. I'll find a way. Amen. I'll get me a pen with a cross on it and put it in my pocket. Talk to me, anybody. We've got to find a way. Turn to somebody and say, you're just too quiet. It's too quiet. Too quiet. Too quiet. Too quiet. Too quiet. Too quiet. All right. Brothers and sisters, Hannah prays to the Lord and gets an answer from Eli, the servant of the Lord. Brothers and sisters, I've come to tell you, surround yourself with people that know God. Obey God. And preach the word of God. You with me? Amen. I don't want to go no further. Paul says, be followers of me even as I am of Christ Jesus. Yeah. I got to be around people that know God, that obey God, that preach the word of God, that have the Bible. If you want to be around somebody that's really important, they got to know the word of God. Amen. Amen. If they don't know the word of God, they're just talking normally gossip. Amen. They're talking about anything. You know, if you're talking about Donald Trump, you got to deal with the word of God. The Bible says that we're to give honor to whom honor is due. The Bible says that we're to pray for those that are in positions of authority, that we might lead a quiet and a peaceful life. It's one thing to say, you know, man, he makes me sick. Let me tell you something. You better get over sick and pray that he makes you well. Amen? Amen, 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 amen. So Hannah prays. She gets a word from Eli, and instantly her whole demeanor changes, her expectation changes, and the Bible tells us, look at 1 Samuel 1:19. I'm trying to take you somewhere. I'm trying to take you somewhere. God is able. Turn to your neighbor and say, he's able. Turn to somebody else and say, don't give up. Praise the Lord. Anybody in here hurting? Amen. Let me tell you something. I'm not coming to lay hands on you either. But God is able. You just need to talk to God and surround yourself with people that know God, obey God, and will preach the word of God. And then you got to listen, you got to obey. Praise the Lord. Look at what happens in verse number 19 of 1 Samuel 1. Early the next morning, they arose and worshiped before the Lord and went back to their home in Ramah. The first thing they're going to do, they're going to worship. They got up and they worshiped. And the Bible says, Elkanah, her husband, made love to his wife Hannah, and the Lord remembered her. She got a word from Eli, but the Lord remembered. So in the course of time, Hannah became what? Wait a minute, this is the same woman that was barren, that was crying out in bitterness of soul and praying continuously. Now she's pregnant and gave birth to a son. She called him Samuel, saying, because I've asked of the Lord. Number four, when you make a vow, keep it. When you make a vow, keep it. Just because you're going through a hard place and you vow something, now you get out the hard place, you don't keep the vow? Turn to your neighbor and say, if you make a vow, keep it. Hannah kept the vow she made. God blessed her womb, and she gave birth to a son and called his name Samuel, which means ask of God. People often vow to do something or give something in return for God's favor, but then when the deal goes down, many times we end up with a selective memory. The story is told of a wealthy woman who got sick, and the preacher was called to the hospital to pray for her, possibly for the last time, because she was making her way out of here. Before praying, the woman woke up and she made a deathbed pledge. She says, if I come through this, Pastor, I'm going to give $100,000 to the church. And then she drifted off again. Well, the pastor prayed for that woman, and miraculously she recovered. But months passed, and she didn't even mention the gift. The pastor decided he was going to ask about the pledge that she had made when she thought she was dying. The woman looked at him, and she says, Pastor, did I say that? All right. Well, that just goes to show you how sick I was. Too many folks have selective memory when it comes to God, but that was not Hannah's testimony. True to her vow, when Samuel was weaned, she packed his bags and took him to live permanently with Eli, the aged priest and judge of Israel. Now watch this, and the Lord dropped this in my spirit. That could have been one of the hardest things she'd ever done, but she did it. And the Lord dropped this in my spirit. I didn't hear no audible voice, just my experiences helped me to understand, and the Word of God helps me to understand. That may have been one of the most difficult things for me. Not necessarily difficult for her. She may have been just so glad I got a male child. She may have been saying, my baby is going to live with the priest judge Eli. He's going to live in the temple. He's going to be a representative for God. From you and me, that may be hard. But for her, she may be saying, to God be the glory. Are you all staying with me? What's hard for one of us isn't hard for all of us. Are you all staying with me? Now you all looking at me like I'm crazy. Mother's like, I wouldn't want my baby to go up there. Let me tell you something. Every day babies are going somewhere. They usually get to be 18 before they go. Talk to me, mothers. It's no easier because they're 18 years old. Let me tell you, when we took Lloyd to school, I dropped him off in Nashville. I don't know what was wrong with me. I cried all night long. We are still in Nashville, and I'm crying. I don't think I wrote him but one letter in my life, and that night I wrote him a letter. Dear son. That would have been hard for me. Amen. I like keeping people close. But that's not everybody's testimony. That's not everybody's testimony. That brings me to my fifth point. My last point. Enjoy the blessing. Enjoy the blessing. Amen. Enjoy the blessing. Because she kept her vow, the Lord not only blessed her with one child, he also blessed her womb over and over and over again. I want to share this with you. You can write this down. You will never do anything for God without being blessed by God. Amen. You will never do anything for God without being blessed by God. Look at 1 Samuel chapter 2, verse 21. 1 Samuel 2:21. The Lord visited Hannah so that she conceived, watch this, and bare three sons and two daughters. And the child Samuel grew before the Lord. Can you see how God is blessing her? She can't have one child. Suddenly, she's got five. History would have us to know that Samuel, her firstborn, became one of the greatest leaders Israel has ever known. It's amazing what God will do to fulfill his purpose. Some of you here today may be going through one of the most difficult periods in your life. Like Hannah, you're doing the right things in the right ways for the right reasons, but things just are not going in the right direction. You're praying and asking God to help, but there's no breakthrough. Well, God would have me to come to tell you today, don't you give up. Don't lose heart, and don't you quit. I'm here to tell you your blessing is on the way, but giving praise right where you are. Remind yourself every day, God did not bring me this far to leave me now. Surround yourself with godly people. Surround yourself with visionaries. Surround yourself with faith-filled people. Surround yourself with Bible-filled people. People that will give you a word that will cause the Spirit of God on the inside of you to leap. Stay focused on the Lord and the vision that he has birthed in your spirit. And even if there's no one to motivate you, if there's no one to inspire you, to stimulate you, or encourage you, learn how to encourage yourself in the Lord. Learn how to speak over yourself in the name of Jesus. Father God, I'm yours and I know that you're mine. The story is told of a boy who at the age of 7 had to go to work to support his family. At 9, his mother died. At 21, he lost his job as a store clerk. At 23, he went into debt and became a partner in a small store. At 26, his partner died, leaving him in great debt. At the age of 37, he had been defeated twice for a seat in Congress. He won the seat. At 39, he lost his reelection bid. At 41, his four-year-old son died. At 45, he ran for the Senate and lost. At 47, he was defeated for the nomination for vice president. At 49, he ran for the Senate again and lost again. But at the age of 51, Abraham Lincoln was elected the 16th president of these United States of America. Don't tell anybody I told you, but that was the president who signed the Emancipation Proclamation. And even though he was assassinated, everybody dies. Are you listening to me? Everybody's got to go. Not only did he inspire the nation then, but he still has a great impact on the lives of many Americans today, including our former president, Barack Obama. Listen, brothers and sisters, always remember, the race is not to the swift, the battle is not to the strong, but in he that endures to the end, the same shall be saved. For those who don't give up, the same shall be healed, the same shall be delivered, the same shall be set free, the same shall walk in victory. Now, I know it may get hard at times, but quitting is not an option. Whatever you do, never, 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 never give up. Weeping may endure for a night, but joy cometh in the morning. Give him praise, give him glory, give him honor. He deserves.